Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Kalani Craig. With me is Seth Denbo, who's the Director of Scholarly Communications at the American Historical Association. And we are live from Indiana University today with a fabulous IQ wall behind us, doing the very first of the AHA 2016 events. This is the plenary speech for the introductory digital history workshop that we've done for the last now 3 years at the AHA. And we're doing it ahead of time for three reasons. First, so that those of you who are registered have a little bit of time to process some of the things that we're talking about today. We also are giving the people who haven't registered yet and want to decide if they're going to come the chance to see what the workshop is all about. And finally, really, the AHA serves a really broad community that may not all make it to the annual meeting, and we wanted to make sure that we were serving the portion of our community that couldn't come to Atlanta. So if you're joining us for that reason, welcome. We are also going to archive this on YouTube. So if you are coming to us via a YouTube archive, hello and welcome. We hope that the Q&A that our live audience is providing will be of some use to you. If you're in the live audience, we'll talk about how to do Q&A in a minute. But I also want to introduce Daniel Story, who is a graduate student here at Indiana University. He'll be moderating today's Hangout. And many of you who are signed up for the workshop or will sign up for the workshop will get email from Rebecca Wingo, who is our registration coordinator and who's also doing the hard work of answering your questions about which of the introductory and intermediate sessions that you should take if you are actually registering for the workshop. And on that note, I'll turn it over to Seth, who will talk about what we're doing today.
Yes, and as Kalani said, we're going to have a text-based Q&A chat at the end of this. Please think about questions. This will greatly improve the quality of the video and its usefulness to others who are watching it later on. So please do weigh in with your questions, and we'll tell you a bit in a minute how to go about doing that. So I'm going to start by talking very generally about digital humanities and digital history a little more specifically, and talking about how it's really what people in the digital humanities often refer to as a big tent. And we are in no way going to try to define the entirety of that tent today and talk about everything that fits under that big top. Instead, we are going to talk about the tools and methodologies that really will help you to solve problems and answer questions in your research and teaching. And this is really our key point, that this should be about historical inquiry and historical scholarship. It's about trying to find the tools and methodologies that will help you to answer, ask, and teach about your, and can finally and ultimately communicate about your scholarship, not about the latest, greatest new tool or whatever that happens to be. And really, we're talking here about elements that we find exciting or instructional or useful. And we realize that there is value in seeing two people talk about the different perspectives they have as a way of kind of communicating these ideas. So that's kind of what you'll see today. But there are a few kind of guiding principles that will help us pick the four projects we're going to use as exemplars during the course of this conversation for the next 30 minutes or so. And those four guiding principles, first of all, the projects all demonstrate careful project-based tool choices. They thought very long and hard about what would be the most valuable tool for their research and for their scholarship. The second one is that they've considered long-term sustainability, and we'll talk about this in more depth afterwards as we get into the talk a bit more, but sustainability is very important. The projects are of a varied scale. We've got some small, fairly compact projects. We also have some very big, very ambitious projects. And finally, and this is a really important principle of digital humanities and of digital history, is that all of these projects are open and available to the public for free. So just wanted one more logistical point. We will set up a shared Google Doc with all of the links for the projects we're looking at, including the collection that includes, shouldn't we have next slide? This georeferenced map of the 1776 Battle of Harlem, which comes from the British Library. We can talk a bit more about the Google Doc and how we would like people to contribute to it later on.
We also have a few other practical things. So as we're moving toward the AHA, connecting with the community is a big part of the digital history world. And we've got a few of our Twitter handles as the first slide of this particular talk. Seth_Denbo, I'm Kalani Craig. But there are also some hashtags, Twitter Storians and DigHist, that will give you more than just this plenary as we move along. We also want to encourage you to ask and upvote questions throughout the course of this live Google Hangout. In the bottom right-hand corner of your screen, you should see a blue Q&A button or a link that says Ask a Question. If you click on that, it'll give you a text input form that you can ask a question with. Our moderator here will walk through the questions as the talk proceeds, and at the end of the talk, we'll go through and answer some of the questions that you've given us as the talk goes along. If you see one that you particularly like that's asked in a particularly useful way, please upvote it so that we can focus on the questions that have more than one upvote. And that'll really, again, help contribute to the value that this particular Hangout has for all the people who watch it in its archived form.
Right, so now getting into some of these projects that we're going to talk about. The first one is a project called the History Harvest. This is a project which is using crowdsourcing to create archives of primary sources. And one of the important things about this is that that history isn't just in the archives. In this case, it's actually in your grandmother's attic. Since History Harvest began in 2010 at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, they've set up a series of events that involve the project leaders and undergraduates in going out into the community and encouraging people to bring the archival traces, the historical objects and documents that they have in their attics, that they have in their family archives, if you will. And these events have really generated community involvement and media interest, and according to the project's website, have really actually been very popular with undergraduate students who have described their participation as challenging, rewarding, and even transformative. It combines, so one of the interesting things and useful things to know about this project, and this is true of more and more digital history projects, is that it combines undergraduate education with community outreach. These events have been sort of, and also have been a key to building a really impressive collection of primary sources that otherwise really would have been lost to history.
So Seth has pointed out the open public nature, which was one of the things that we wanted to emphasize. One of the other things that's really nice about History Harvest is that it shows two levels of scale. It's a big, big project. The University of Nebraska community has really come together. There are a lot of undergraduates involved. The entire history department has at some point or another been part of this. But it also uses a small scale technical backup. This is an Omeka install, which is a content management system out of George Mason that has been built to provide historians and archivists with the kinds of information about documents that make archives work for us and as display objects. What I'm talking about when I say that are all of these specific pieces of metadata, the titles, the descriptions that describe what is in a document without you having to open the document. And the scale at which they've used Omeka is really small. They haven't done a lot of customization. They're using its built-in access to the Dublin Core, which is a particular kind of metadata organization, to make the History Harvest function well and effectively. And that's a really important lesson for people who are DIYing projects that seem like they might be large scale, but could have economies of scale in other ways.
So one of the other exciting things about this project is the way it combines kind of old-fashioned kinds of historical methodologies, traditional kinds of historical approaches like oral history interviews. People not only bring their objects, they're recorded describing their objects and also being interviewed about their own past and their family's past. So it combines that kind of oral history methodology with a digital methodology, which is important. So creating audio files, it's important from the point of view of preservation and sustainability of this project. It's also important from the point of view of access. So these aren't, you know, traditionally oral history interview tapes would have been, you know, shoved in an archive, a university archive somewhere, you know, put on the shelf in some professor's office. But now they're available on the web and open to whoever wants to get a hold of them. So I think that's a really important feature, is the way in which the web enables much broader access to this stuff.
And that's the real takeaway from the History Harvest, is that it is, in a very real sense, the integration of a real historical past with the public history that is so important to connecting universities to the communities in which they're embedded, and with the student body as one of the things that connects that university and the community in which it's embedded.
So for the last slide about the History Project, History Harvest, is we're going to talk about another similar project from the University of Iowa Libraries called DIY History. And what's interesting about this in relation to the History Harvest is that they've used some similar methodologies. They're building an archive of primary sources using Omeka, but they've also done some development of their own on top of Omeka to create a transcription desk. So it's possible for their undergraduates and others involved in this project to go on and transcribe these primary sources that you see on the slide. So they're using a tool off the shelf, but developing it in ways that make it more valuable to their own project. So the next project we would like to talk about is TAPAS. TAPAS is an acronym for TEI Archive Publishing and Access Service. And really what I think is the reason why we picked this one out is that this is explicitly about helping build capacity for digital scholarship in the humanities at institutions that may only have a few scholars doing digital scholarship and really no infrastructure, no DH center, no large-scale support from their library or whatever. So that's a really important aspect of what makes this project valuable.
One of these projects is a digital version of the pamphlet called A Narrative of the Proceedings of the Black People. It's a 1794 document. The TEI market was generated by Molly Hardy, who's an ACLS fellowship as digital humanities curator at the American Antiquarian Society. And this particular pamphlet down here really nicely illustrates some of the affordances of TEI when you're thinking about digital sustainability and maintenance. So here you can see an image of the pamphlet cover. And if you dig deeper into the TEI version of the document, what you get is some of the TEI interpreter. It's a formatting system that takes marked up text that comes out of this document and displays it in ways that sort of mimic the existing pamphlet. The really valuable thing about TEI, though, and we just saw this in some of the work that is at the History Harvest, is that it's not markup oriented toward layout. It's markup oriented toward semantic information or meaning. In HTML, what we get is a headline or an image or a caption, and that's really about where something is placed on a page. In TEI, what we get is what something does in a document. So a paragraph might be one of the markup pieces for a document that's in prose, or a line or a stanza might be something that shows up in a poem. The idea then is that the document metadata or the descriptive information about it travels with the document itself in a basic text format that uses tagging and is easily readable both by humans who know TEI and by a computer interpreter that can display it to people who don't read TEI. It contains metadata. You can see that here in the header where we talk about the document title and who the authors are. It's also got markup in the text, which contains the kinds of things that we can use to interpret the text. So for instance, here, even if you don't read markup well, you can actually zoom in on this line and it says author. So we know that anything that comes between these two author tags is really gonna be about who wrote the document. There's a person name. So it's not totally human readable, but it is possible to read through TEI. And one of the things that this is important for in terms of sustainability is that the version of this document that contains both the information from the original pamphlet and Molly Hardy's information, which is her interpretation of what's important about the document, is all contained in a single place. It's hard to destroy this. It's not in a Microsoft Word format that you have to update Microsoft Word every couple of years, open the document, and save it in order to maintain the document as a structural whole. And so these three things together combine to make this a really sustainable version of this document in a digitally surrogate form.
And Kalani's just used a favorite two words of people who do digital scholarship, which is this idea of a digital surrogate. And I think one of the important things to understand about any digital version of a text, whether we're talking about something marked up and transcribed and marked up in this way, whether we're talking about an actual JPEG of the image itself, of the image of the page itself, or whether we're talking about any of the other kinds of things that might be a digital version of an actual primary source, is that these are different. That is not to say that they are bad or worse than the original. I mean, in some cases, it's possible to do things with the digital versions of the of the text that you couldn't do with the original, with the pieces of paper or the image or whatever. I mean, one of the most well-known projects that has done this is a project called the Archimedes Palimpsest. And this is a project that used multispectral imaging to uncover a Byzantine document written on the same pieces of vellum as a 13th century text, and is an incredibly valuable and of useful undertaking for scholars of that period. And one other point to make about these digital representations, these surrogates of original primary sources, is that they are really creating them as a scholarly activity, is I guess the best way of putting it. The act of turning something into TEI, the act of taking information out of primary sources and putting it in specific fields in a spreadsheet or a database, is an act of interpretation, is an act that has scholarly implications and scholarly activity involved in it. Right, and I'm up again, talking about trading consequences, which is a project funded by an interesting funding stream called Digging Into Data, which was a collaboration of the National Endowment for the Humanities and several similar government funding agencies in various European countries. And it put together international collaborations to do some really, really exciting projects. This one's called Trading Consequences. It's about 19th century trade, if you will, supply chains for 19th century goods. It uses WordPress, and it uses WordPress in a very basic way. They've done very little additional development. But one thing that's interesting they've done is they've combined WordPress with a free tool from a supply chain management company. So, you know, you wouldn't immediately think that history and supply chain management have a huge amount in common, but we'll see in a minute the ways in which they've used this to do some pretty cool stuff.
So underneath the hood of Trading Consequences are actually several elements that drew Seth and I to it. It's not just the WordPress and the supply chain management. It's that the research that's being done here is built on a project that combines text mining, data visualization, and spatial history. The data set that underpins this particular set of visualizations is built from a carefully thought out set of optical character recognition, or OCR, challenges that face people who are trying to mine text that was written in the 19th century. The sources here are the British House of Commons and the Early Canada Online Collections, although there are a few other data sources. And that text mining process is represented by the proximity of particular commodities like sugar, for instance, here in the corpus, we've selected Africa in the map up top. So there's a spatial history component. And the size of a particular country indicates how often that particular country is associated with the sugar trade on a continuum that looks at change over time. So this column here is for 1800, this is 1810, and so on as you move down each of the decades that are part of this particular visualization.
So it gives you an idea of the changing influence of the changing ways in which the country, the changing amounts that the countries are mentioned in this set of texts. But one of the things I want to point out, and if you look at the way in which Great Britain's influence and relationship to the slave trade in this particular sugar trade in this particular corpus changes, is that this is to make a point about the importance of historical knowledge for this scholarship. The computer isn't going to do history for you. It isn't going to become the historian. It's going to help you interpret data. It's going to help you to visualize data in this case, so that you can then do the work of the historian in the same way that other tools and methodologies that we've used as a discipline in the past have helped us to do the work of a historian. So, you know, you need to know as a historian that Great Britain wasn't a sugar producing nation, but Great Britain, of course, because of its position in the empire as the metropolis, as the center, has a very important role to play in the sugar trade. So you need to know these things to help interpret the data.
So I'm going to go back to what Seth talked about earlier, which is the idea of using an off-the-shelf supply chain. In the same way that you can't take the historian out of the digital history, you can, in fact, think about using tools that aren't necessarily intended for history in service of a historian's purpose. In this case, it's a map of West Ham's industry. So it's an early foray into the trading consequences data that was done by one of the PIs, Jim Clifford. And it's really fascinating. Seth and I were immediately drawn to the underwater cables here, which both of us looked at and thought, in the 19th century? That was an exciting discovery for us because it was a really interesting thing, but it's particularly highlighted well in a tool that's intended for modern companies to track where their trucks are and, you know, what kinds of oil trade they're doing across the globe. So in one sense, this is a really clever use of an existing technology. But if you think back to the kinds of things that we emphasized when we were talking about TAPAS and TEI, the sustainability question then becomes the thing that's a necessary evil. When you are dependent on someone else's technology for a fabulous visualization like this, what happens in 10 years? So here, what's really nice is that the PIs for this trading consequences project in its early phases made a decision to develop quickly using a platform that may not be as sustainable in order to demonstrate some of the really fabulous conclusions that they came to. And that's a really important question when we're thinking about graceful degradation. Not everything has to stay around forever, but it's important to think about when and where you make that trade-off. The final project that we wanted to look at is both a fantastic example of the kinds of questions first, tools later that we've been emphasizing, but it's also a little bit of a rule breaker here in terms of what kinds of projects we've looked at so far. In terms of scalability, this is a 3D image visualization of the St. Paul's Cross. It's advanced modeling and data visualization in service of a microhistorical recreation, in this case, the Guy Fawkes Day speech that John Donne delivered in the 16th century, in 1622 here. And we've talked about crowdsourcing, we've talked about big data, we've talked about a lot of other stuff, but one of the things that we haven't dealt with is the way that big data and large-scale digital history projects can be applied to microhistorical scale information. It's a nice way of thinking about the pedagogical value of a huge project as it applies to the individual perspective of one student who might find themselves embedded in a historical event in ways that they never would have been able to encounter this event before.
So if people who follow me on Twitter or Facebook or whatever are getting bored of me talking about this project, because I think it is one of the most incredible digital history, digital humanities projects out there. It has incredible possibilities for thinking, for helping us to think about the ways in which people experience space, place, time, and sound. And with modeling, you can do all of that. You know, they model the audio properties of St. Paul's Churchyard, as well as the video, the actual space itself and the architecture. This is not where you start. This is, you know, one of the things I think we need to say about this project is not just that it's an incredible project, but, like, you know, don't try this at home. This is not the beginning of doing digital history. This is a very advanced project, but at the same time, it's one that shows some of the imaginative possibilities that digital scholarship brings to our discipline.
And before we move on, I really quickly want to plug the fact that we do in fact have a 3D visualization workshop, one of the 3-hour-long intermediate tool encounter workshops that will happen on January 7 in Atlanta is specifically designed to give people a quick introduction into the world of 3D visualization in history. It doesn't require you to have a significant amount of experience, and that's true of most of our intermediate workshops. But we are branching out and starting to look at some of the value in encountering these kinds of really high-end, difficult to manage, difficult to produce projects, even at beginning stages of the digital historian's career. And that emphasizes one of the really important things that we wanted to talk about sort of as an overview, and that is that many of the things we've looked at have a very significant collaborative component to them. It's collaboration with librarians and library staff and faculty. It's collaboration with undergraduates. It's collaboration with local public history and regional and national history organizations. It's collaboration with other universities. And finding the necessary time and space to manage a collaborative project like that requires funding. So one of the things that we've done the last couple of years is asked Jennifer Cerventi to come talk to us about the funding that's provided at the NEH, and we wanted to even though we're in Indiana and recording this well ahead of time, we wanted to, I guess, inhabit Jen's personality briefly for a few moments to talk to you about the kinds of things that are valuable for particularly beginning digital historians as they think about where their practice is going in terms of funding. The real issue is involvement at state, at regional, and at national levels. Going to local, state, historical societies and getting involved, making sure that you know who you can collaborate with locally. Thinking about the AHA and digital history as a community that is not just an annual meeting kind of thing. Using Twitter to build connections with other historians, and then finally making sure that that community also happens in person. That you're not just submitting a grant to the NEH without having talked to them. Jen emphasizes this as very important, that you go look at the NEH's page. They've got a grants link that's very specific, and the Office of Digital Humanities has its own page under that grants list, but also that you go talk to the people who are in the Office of Digital Humanities in person or on the phone. And we've provided Jennifer's Twitter handle so that you can go talk to her. We've provided the NEH's link to the ODH and the ODH's Twitter handle. But making sure that those connections that you build with people via Twitter, via digital history workshops in person, and via calls to the larger funding agencies become a part of your collaborative process right from the very beginning of your practitioning time as a digital historian.
So I'm going to finish us off with us talking at you version of part of this webcast. With a few plugs for digital stuff, digital events, digital sessions at the American Historical Association meeting in Atlanta in January. First of all, if you haven't already signed up for the workshop, please do. We are again producing an annual meeting app that will be available in early December. There will be a digital track. The schedule tracks, thematic tracks, I think one of them will be digital. So you'll be able to look at a glance and see all of the digital things that are going on at the meeting. Come to that Camp AHA, January 6th, which is the day before the conference at Georgia State University. And here's the URL for registering for that camp. And that camps are another great way of getting an introduction to digital history. They're not forbidding events. They're very welcoming, smallish, sort of informal events at which historians who are interested in digital technology or are interested in learning about digital technology can come together and talk about it.
Our final note is that when if you do actually join us at the AHA's Digital History Workshop in January, and again, that's the morning of January 7th, that we will have connections for you to take on larger scale digital history learning. We have a lunch at noon that happens after the workshop and our introductory and intermediate sessions. And that lunch is in part sponsored by the ACH, the Association for Computers and the Humanities, and HILT, the Humanities Institute for Learning and Technology. They, together with DHSI, the Digital Humanities Summer Institute, offer long, large-scale, two-week-long, in some cases, training in advanced digital history methodologies, and we can't encourage the people who have either been part of the digital history workshop already or are going to be enough to go hunt down those kinds of training opportunities, because it really does make a difference. There's a massive, massive learning curve between a three-hour workshop and a two-week workshop, and we want to really encourage people to go find those longer workshops and take advantage of them. So I think at this point, we're ready to take questions if we have any. Which we may not, we know that we're early on in the AHA annual meeting cycle. What we would encourage you to do if you are watching this live is to send a question into Daniel. And if you choose not to, or you've reached the end of your ability to make time out of your busy day, what we'd also like to encourage you to come to Twitter and ask us questions. Our hashtag is AHAGSDH, Getting Started in Digital History. And Seth and I will be happy to answer questions between now and January as the workshop approaches. So unless we have any questions, then I think what we'll do is sign off, and we'll see you all in Atlanta in January.
We'll give you a minute or two if you're typing your question or thinking about your question, and then we'll sign off and The other thing I should say is feel free to email me. My email is, you can find my email on the AHA site. And I'm more than happy to respond and help you with your digital history questions.
Oh, we do. We have a question.
Great.
This is from Stephanie Kinsey. She asks, in works of digital scholarship,
so we have a question from Stephanie, who's asking if works of digital scholarship can be considered for tenure. And in fact, Seth and I are both partly implicated in this, Seth more so than I am. The AHA has just released official scholarship guidelines for the evaluation of digital research. And I think you're making the rounds talking about that to some extent. So
I am. We'll be doing a workshop on it here tomorrow morning. This is a complicated question. Different departments have different guidelines of their own, different requirements for what for tenure and hiring, but it's something the AHA is actively working on and trying to help departments to and scholars who are doing digital history and departments who want to hire and promote those scholars to figure out ways to embed it in the discipline and make sure that people get the professional credit they deserve for what is becoming an increasingly important part of our discipline.
There is a digital history working group that the AHA has established as part of that. I'm on it. Jason Kelly is on it. Michelle Moravec at Rosemont College. Jeff McClurkin at George Washington. And I think there are
and a few other people who I can't
people.
Think of
Jason
off the top
Kelly
of my head.
Jason Kelly at IEPY.
Yes.
I'm not going to remember all of them off the top of my head. So I apologize if I left you out. But the discipline as a whole is sort of attempting to answer that question. And there are a number of us who are informally now part of the answering process. So I encourage you to go to the AHA's website and look at the scholarship guidelines, look at the committee who is providing assistance. Seth can obviously help out, but if you're afraid to call him, because he's really scary. You can always get in touch with one of the people who's on the working group committee. There's a wide variety of public institutions, private institutions, liberal arts colleges, because digital history projects have penetrated really well into the discipline, and it'll give you a sense of who's involved and who you can contact who might look like your situation or be able to give you the best guidelines for the situation that you're in.
But that said, if you're just thinking about getting involved in digital scholarship, then worry about the scholarship. It's obviously tenure and promotion, and the kinds of professional credit we get for this kind of work are important, but equally, pursue the scholarship because it's interesting and exciting and valuable to you and the discipline, and then we'll work on the other side of it as well.
That's one of the reasons that Seth and I chose to emphasize tools as a tool, not as a fun thing to play with. If you think about the question first, I had it recently explained to me that maybe we should ask, does digital history make me a better historian? And if you can answer that question with a yes, as you work through the project that has digital components in it, then it will sort of naturally lend itself to becoming part of a research and a tenure and promotion case that that makes a difference for you.
Okay, we have another question here from Vincent Melly. The question is, what would you recommend the best way to find collaborators for digital?
So we have a question from Vincent Malik, who's asked, what's the best way to find collaborators for a digital history project? And I think Seth and I probably have very different answers. So I can start. And mine is the sort of techno-optimist version on Twitter. While Twitter and any social media community really can obviously have its problems, one of the things that I've experienced on Twitter as a digital historian, both early career and as a graduate student, is that it is a place for where ideas get posted. It's the easiest way to keep track of the sort of historiography of digital history, to find people who are interested in the same kinds of subfields and questions that you are. Mm. And it also gives you, I think, a better handle on who might be interested in your local community. You'll see lots and lots of people in informatics departments doing digital history in very humanities, with very humanities style approaches. And knowing that there were informatics people on Twitter was one of the things that drove me to seek out some of the informatics people here at IU, who are doing really interesting projects that are very much in a historian's bailiwick, to use a nice 18th century word, for the purposes of, say, graphic novel history. And I think that's one of the things, like combining what you see on Twitter, assuming that there are patterns because we're historians and we look for them, assuming that those patterns will map to the real world, and then going to look for the people who look like your friends on Twitter is one of the better ways to find collaborators.
I agree that Twitter is valuable. Social media to the non-initiated can be a little daunting sometimes. But I think the second part of Kalani's point is vital. Start on your own campus or in your own university system if you're part of a system of state schools, or start with in your local urban area if there's a coalition of schools that are together because they happen to be in the same city or whatever. That's the best place to start. If I'm turning blue right now, it's because I'm going blue in the face from saying this. Talk to people in your library. This is actually really important and doesn't happen enough. Librarians are, as one digital historian I know called it the intellectuals of the information age. These are the people who have put a lot of time and effort and energy and knowledge and training into understanding the way in which our scholarly communication and our disciplines are changing, and they can really help. And that's both in terms of learning about tools, learning what else is going on in other departments on your campus. So look around. And the other thing I would say is there is one particular sort of not exactly social networking, but professional networking site called dhcommons.org, which exists specifically for that purpose, to help people find collaborators. So that's a site that's at least worth having a look at.
I'm going to add two things to Seth's point, and one of them is to reemphasize the library faculty and staff. And I say that not as myself, I say that channeling Jennifer Cerventi from the NEH, who has said a number of times that if you don't have a librarian on your grant proposal PI list, that the NEH is less likely to look at it, because librarians have, as Seth notes, a really good feel for what's happening in the field at large, because they are providing the tools and the sustainability and data management resources that make digital humanities projects possible. So I'll second the librarian focus, but from a slightly different perspective. The other thing that I might mention is that there are a number of, in addition to the training institutes, which are great ways to find collaborations, DHSI, HILT, there are almost always regional and local workshops for digital historians, many of them put together by your local library staff. But there are also several now digital humanities conferences. The ACH hosts the Digital Humanities Conference next summer in Poland. And even if you can't go, looking at who's contributing to it, signing up as a peer reviewer, so that you have a better handle on what's happening in the field, is a really great way to find collaborators in a sort of more traditional peer review conference-y kind of way.
Good. Well, those were two excellent questions. Thank you very much. If there are no more, we will sign off and say welcome to those people who are watching this in repeat on YouTube. And get in touch if you have any questions.
And I think remind those of you who are watching this between now, it's October 12, and say December 15, that if you haven't signed up for the Digital History Workshop and you are coming to Atlanta, please come sign up for the Digital History Workshop. It's one of the great ways to meet collaborators and to get your feet wet in the digital history pool.
And the lunch is heavily subsidized for graduate students. It probably will be the cheapest place to get lunch that day in Atlanta.
Thanks very much, everyone, for joining us. Oh, we have another question.
One more question.
All right,
excellent.
So I guess we're going to stick around. It's going to be the Return of the Kings version with like 8 different endings.
She asked, what kinds of topics will you be talking about in the beginner track of the workshop?
What kinds of topics do we have in the introductory track at the Digital History Workshop, asks one of our viewers. We have a spatial history, which is a short track on how you can incorporate at a very low level GIS into your research and your classroom experience. We have a track on public history and digital history that looks at how digital history makes its way into public history spaces and how some digital public history integrates the two. We have a track on data management. We have a track on, I'm going to forget them all now.
Send people to the website.
Yes, I should send people to the website. The AHA, it's historians.org. In the annual meeting section, there is a digital history page that has all of our sections listed. There are 5 basic introductory tracks. Each of our introductory session attendees gets to go to 2 of them. They're short 45-minute overviews so that you really get a better feel for the field as a whole. And our intermediate workshops are 3 hours long. They have a short theory base on whatever it is that you're looking at. We have network analysis, 3D imaging, oral digital history, and so on, followed by a tool encounter. So you spend two or so hours actually getting to know and use one of the tools that digital historians commonly use for that particular topic. And we're officially signing off again, hopefully for the last time. But again, we want to encourage you to come to Atlanta if you are watching this between now and January. And if you're not, we hope that this has been helpful and that if you have any follow-up questions, we will get in touch with Seth or I by Twitter, by email, or by phone. We are happy to take phone calls, even though technically, you know, we should be eschewing that sort of Luddite technology for the wave of the future. Thank you very much for joining us, and we will hopefully see you in Atlanta.
Thank you, everyone.